you to New Hope Online. We are so delighted and encouraged that you have chosen to carve out a few minutes to watch today's message. We are in this series of messages on the 12 disciples that Jesus picked to become his followers, and we are digging into each one of these 12 men. And so what I want you to do is I want you to take out your iPhone, iPad, tablet, or whatever you use to read and study God's Word, and turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4, and verse 21, and here's what it says. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I cannot. You never said I could. You can. You always said you would. And so I ask you, the Holy Spirit, to make my tongue a paper-mate pen, giving your word a free course to travel, and may it find a lodging place in the hearts of people today. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to meet the needs of your precious people today. And I pray this prayer with a grateful heart and with a humble heart. And I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, a few months ago, Marianne's sister Ruth, who lives in Spokane with her husband Jim, decided to travel cross state to Olympia to spend a couple of days with Marianne and myself. And she wanted to bond with our grandchildren, as well as seeing her sister and me again. And so she spent a couple of days with us. And on a Sunday night, she took all of us out for Sunday dinner to the Olive Gardens, and the grandchildren really enjoyed the time that they had to get to know Aunt Ruth just a little bit better. And so while she was here, she asked me if I had seen The Chosen. And I said, no, I have not. As a matter of fact, I haven't even heard of the series The Chosen. Well, she said she hadn't watched it either. And so after she left town, I decided to investigate this series called The Chosen. And so I did. Marianne and I have watched several episodes of The Chosen, and now it's in season 2. And it's a story of how Jesus went about picking out and choosing his 12 disciples and how he interacted with each one of them. And folks, I want to tell you something. I highly recommend that you see and watch The Chosen. And stop and think about it for a moment. Jesus picked 12 men methodically and filled with the Holy Spirit. And at that time of Jesus' day, there were about 250 million people. And out of that sea of humanity, Jesus picked 12 men to become his followers. And so I begin to think about each one of these men. And the truth of the matter is, I don't think in our church culture, too many people know the history of these 12 men. I dare say that some of us can't even remember all 12 names of these disciples. And so I decided that it was worth our time to dig into the lives of each one of these 12 men. And so that's why we are in this series of the 12 disciples. Now, we've talked about Andrew, we've talked about Peter, we've talked about Philip. Last Sunday we talked about Nathaniel, and today we're going to be talking about the disciple of love. And that disciple's name is John. And so, there's got to be a reason why Jesus picked these 12 men. And today, there are 2.2 billion people who call themselves Christians, and it all started way back with these 12 men. As a matter of fact, when we get to heaven, we will see the names of these 12 men written on the walls. And so these 12 men turned the world upside down. That's what the Bible says. And so we want to talk about each one of these disciples. Today our focus is upon John. And John is the only one who died a natural death. All the other disciples were martyred. But John lived to be an old man. And so as we open up the life of John, the disciple of love, I want us to see three things. There's three things in the life of John that I want to call your attention to. Number one, I want us to talk about John, the person. John, the person. The Bible says that Jesus passed by a boat. He passed by a boat, and there was a man who owned a fishing business. He was quite successful with his fishing business. His name was Zebedee, and he had two sons. One was named James, and the other one was named John. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw this boat on the Sea of Galilee. Now, the Sea of Galilee is really a lake more so than it is a sea, because it's 7 miles wide, 13 miles long, and 250 feet at its deepest point, 200 feet at its deepest point. And so this is what I believe. I believe with all of my heart that God chooses ordinary people to become his disciples. Because when he chooses ordinary people, God's the one that gets the glory and the honor and the praise. It's interesting to me that Jesus didn't go into the synagogue or the temple to look for his 12 disciples. He didn't go into the Pharisee crowd looking for the disciples. He chose unchurched people, unchurched men who were uneducated to become his disciples. And so God uses, folks, ordinary people. I like what Abraham Lincoln said. He said, God must love common people because he made so many of them. It's true. The Bible says common people receive Jesus gladly. So, you know, the Bible is full of stories of how God picked unchurched people to become believers. As a matter of fact, I'm looking into developing another series of messages called Divine Encounters, when Jesus met people with specific needs, and he met those needs. Common people received Jesus gladly, just ordinary people. Now, you know, the greatest evangelist who has lived in our century, our culture, was Billy Graham. He said on one occasion, he was asked, Billy, what questions do you have when you get to heaven that you would like to ask God? And so Billy Graham responded, if I get an opportunity when I get to heaven to ask God a question, I'm going to ask him, God, why did you pick a farm boy from the hills of North Carolina to reach so many people? Well, Billy Graham was 30 years old, and he goes to Los Angeles, California to have a crusade out there. It was supposed to last 3 weeks. It ended up lasting 8 weeks. And there was a maid, a black maid, and she went on the very first night and she didn't miss one night of those meetings. And she was going to the crusade, and she was coming back, and she was having the time of her life. And this black maid was a maid to William Randolph Hearst. Now, today, probably a lot of people don't know who William Randolph Hearst was, but in his prime, in his day, he was the media mogul, and he owned better than 90% of the newspapers in America. He controlled the media. And every morning, while this black maid was fixing biscuits and gravy and scrambling eggs for William Randolph Hearst, she said, "Mr. Hearst, you need to go to the meeting last night. Oh, you missed the meeting last night. You need to go tonight." She said, "God came down and heaven filled our soul." And she said, "Mr. Hearst, you've just got to go tomorrow night to this Billy Graham crusade." She said, "You've just got to get under the spout that where the glory comes," using her verbiage, "and you just got to go to this meeting." Well, William Hearst never did go to a meeting of Billy Graham's crusade, but he did something. He said all of his media outlook, he put them on notice with just two words. And those two words were, "Puff Billy Graham." Puff Billy Graham. That was lingo for putting Billy Graham on the front page of every newspaper. "Put Billy Graham," he said, "let him be the number one story on every media, every newspaper. Let Billy Graham be the number one story, the story," because he did that in response to his black maid's enthusiasm for the Crusades. And so he went ahead and did that, and that launched the Billy Graham ministry and the crusade, where millions upon millions of people have become believers in Jesus because of the ministry of Billy Graham. And he got his launching really from William Randolph Hearst, who instructed all of his newspapers to put Billy Graham on the front page. Last night, I happened to watch the 1957 Billy Graham Crusade in New York. It would be worthwhile your time to watch it. You can find it on YouTube. And Billy Graham packed out Yankee Stadium to an overflowing crowd. There were over 100,000 people jammed in to Yankee Stadium to hear Billy Graham preach. And so I just want to remind us that God uses ordinary people, even a black maid, to inspire William Randolph Hearst to put Billy Graham on the front page of all of his newspapers. And so God uses ordinary people, folks. The only hands God has is our hands. The only feet that God has is our feet. And so, whatever business you might be in, your business should really be all about connecting people to Jesus. A businessman who wrote a book had a big sign on the top of his roof of his business which says, "God owns my business." And so God has put you where you are so that you can make an impact for people, for Jesus, in your relational world. And so John, he was just an ordinary fisherman, unchurched, just an ordinary fisherman. Not only was he a fisherman, but number two, he had some rough edges in his character. If you study his life, he had a lot of faults in his character. He was flawed, as a matter of fact. In Mark chapter 3, verse 17, Jesus gave him a nickname. He and James, he called them sons of thunder, because it was loud. They were loud, boisterous, volatile, and they were outspoken. John, Jesus gave him the nickname of Son of Thunder, as well as his brother James. So what kind of a guy was John? Well, let me explain. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 35 through 37, Jesus was interacting with James and John. And John said, Jesus, by the way, when you come into your glory, you know what I think should happen? And Jesus said, well, what do you think would happen, John? And he said, well, when you come into your glory, Jesus, I think it would be a good idea if you were to put James on one side of you and put me on the other side of you so that we could occupy your throne with you. Now, keep in mind, John was the guy who was writing this Gospel of John and three other books and the book of Revelation, but six times in the Gospel of John, this disciple describes himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. Six times! I mean, folks, John was a guy that had to be the bride at every wedding, and he had to be the course at every funeral. I mean, John, at this season in his life, he was just eaten up with pride. Had a lot of pride in him. And John said, Jesus, I think it's a good idea if you put me and my brother James on your side when you come into your glory. And another occasion, the disciples encountered some Samaritans. Well, the Samaritans did not like the Jews, and the Jews did not like the Samaritans. And we have this story in Luke chapter 19, verses 52 and 56. And as they were approaching these Samaritans, whom the Jews hated, John said, Jesus, why don't you just send down thunder from heaven, fire from heaven, and just zap them? That was John. Doesn't seem like he was a disciple of love at that stage of his life. And then in Luke chapter 9, verses 49 and 50, he says, Jesus, we met up with these people, and they're casting out devils, but they're not part of our 12. They're not part of our group. And so we stopped them from doing it. And the reason we told them to quit it was because they were not part of our group. Let me paraphrase that. Bring it down to our level. We caught another church using our material, and we didn't like it, and we told them to stop. Folks, that is so, so wrong. I firmly believe, I've said this for years, that God uses all kinds of churches to reach all kinds of people. That's true. Every denomination, folks, if you think about it, is man-made. The Lord is nowhere near. All denominations are man-made. And folks, when we get to heaven, there won't be a Methodist denomination up there. There won't be a Presbyterian denomination up there, nor will there be a Pentecostal denomination up there. There won't even be a Baptist denomination up there, or a Church of God denomination up there. Has nothing to do with what denomination we identify with here on earth. What is really important is that who will be in heaven are those people whose names are written in Lamb's Book of Life per Revelation, and they have found and they have put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. These are the ones that are going to be in heaven. And I want you to understand something, folks. John was just an ordinary fisherman, common guy, and John had a lot of faults. He had some rough edges in his character, and he was flawed. Now, I also want to tell you something else. John was a practitioner of the Word of God. John was the practitioner of the Word of God. We have seen John as a person. Now we see John as a practitioner of the Word of God. Well, what do you mean by that? Well, I mean that John becomes an old man. He grows old, and he goes to Ephesus, and he starts writing from Ephesus. He's the pastor of the church at Ephesus, and today, Ephesus, Turkey, which is 99.9% Muslim. But he goes to Ephesus, and he starts writing 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. And if you'll notice, if you ever read 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John, he uses quite frequently the verbiage, my little children. Now, why does he use that phraseology? Simply because he's an old man. And he's referring them to my little children. I read about this husband who said to his wife, honey, will you love me when I'm old and gray? And she said, sweetheart, I do. But John got old, and he started writing the book of John. And he started writing 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. And he started writing from Ephesus, where he was the pastor. Now, folks, Jesus was dying on the cross. John was there. John saw Jesus die on the cross. And John heard those seven statements that were uttered from the lips of Jesus. The last one, where Jesus said, "It is finished." John was standing there at the foot of the cross. Dale, you say, how do you know John was there? Well, do you know your Bible? This is what I want folks to know. I want you to know your Bible. John chapter 19, verse 26 and verse 27. Jesus looked down at John and said, John, take care of Mama. John, take care of Mama. Now, hold on just a minute, folks. Jesus had four brothers and at least two sisters. Why didn't he say to some of his brothers, take care of Mama? Well, the brothers of Jesus didn't come to believe in him until after the resurrection. And so there's a message here for us, folks. God is saying to us many times, the spiritual brother in God's family we are closer to than even our own physical brother, our earthly brother. There's just something about a spiritual relationship. And so we sometimes are even closer to our brothers and sisters in Christ than we are to our physical brothers and sisters. John was there when Jesus said, it is finished. John was there, and he heard those words spoken from Jesus as he was dying on the cross. That's why only John could pen John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world. John was there. He saw Jesus dying. And John knew how much Jesus loved the world. He was willing to die for it. Let me tell you something, folks. John, well, he had a lot of rough edges in his character. He was flawed. He had his share of faults. And Jesus, my oh my, Jesus rebuked him many, many times over. That's why John could write 1 John 1:8 and 9. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. John said, I know this is true because I've had a lot of flaws in my life. I've got a lot of rough edges in my life, but I've got good news that I can share with humanity. Jesus is willing to forgive every single one of my faults and shortcomings. Jesus is willing to forgive me and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And I want you to know that Jesus can forgive you of all your shortcomings and of all of your sins if we confess them before the Lord. Someone said, there's so much bad in the best of us and so much good in the worst of us, it hardly behooves us, any of us, to talk about the rest of us. And folks, that is so true. Husband went to see the doctor. He said, Doc, my wife has a hearing problem, and it's terrible. Doctor said, how bad is it? The husband said, it is really, really bad. The doctor said, well, let's determine just how bad it is. He said, you can ask her a question and move closer to her as you ask the question. He said, I can do that, be glad to do it. So the husband goes home, and he says to his wife, is dinner ready? Silence. Complete silence. No response. So he moves a little bit closer and raises his voice just a little bit. Is dinner ready? And again, nothing. Absolute quietness. And so he steps a little bit closer and he yells at her, is dinner ready? And his wife responded, yes, for the third time, yes, it is ready. So you see, who had the problem? Bible says we all have feet of clay. That's why I'm so glad for 1 John 1:9. It says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Folks, you ought to have that verse highlighted in your Bible. Let me tell you something else about John. John was not only there at the foot of the cross watching Jesus die, and he heard every statement that Jesus uttered as he was dying on the cross. Seven of them. Let me tell you something else. John was also there on the day of Pentecost. He was there when the Holy Spirit came like a mighty rushing wind, and he came in upon that group of disciples. John said, I was there. So he could write John 4:4, little children, you are from God and have overcome them. Here's the key. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. That's why he could write John 4:4, because he was there. You remember when John said, God, these Samaritans, why don't you just call fire down from heaven and zap them? Well, after spending time with God, he ends up, according to Acts 8:14, he goes and he preaches to these Samaritans. Wow. Then he writes 1 John 3:14. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we do what? We love the brethren. Who does not love abides in death. So, folks, here's the bottom line. We cannot love Jesus and hate somebody else. We cannot love Jesus and hate somebody else. You say, Dell, you're rubbing the cat's fur the wrong way. I say, turn the cat around. This is what the scripture says. We can't love Jesus and hate somebody else. Because when you come to know the Lord, the love of God is shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Spirit. Two people cannot be right with God and hate one another. I will say this. You can love the person, but you can hate what you see them doing. So you can use the word love and hate in the same language, in the same sentence. You love the person, but you sure hate what you see that person doing. And so I want you to see something else. We have watched and talked about John the person. We have talked about John the practitioner of the Word of God. And number three, I hurry to finish this message. Let's look at John the prophet. Look at John the prophet. Remember that time in the book of Mark that describes John going out onto the Temple Mount with Jesus. And he said, Jesus, by the way, what's going to be the sign of your second coming? What's going to be the sign when you're coming back? What is going to be the sign when the end of the world is upon us? Jesus, you know, I would like to know that. I just really would like to know, what are the signs that's going to point toward your second coming? Now, remember, I told you that Jesus said, John, I want you to take care of Mama. And he did. He takes Mary, the mother of Jesus, and he goes to Ephesus, and he is pastoring there, the church at Ephesus, and he's writing 1 John, 2 John, 3 John from Ephesus. And at the same time, there's a Roman emperor by the name of Domitian, and Domitian builds a temple to himself, and he demands that all people worship him. And when he did that, well, John addressed him in 2 John chapter 1, verse 7. Look what it says. For many deceivers have come out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus in the flesh. Such a one is the deceiver and the Antichrist. Well, when the Roman emperor Domitian got wind of that, he says, I don't like what John's writing, so I'm going to punish him. And he put him on the Isle of Patmos as a prison. He put him on the Isle of Patmos, which is 10 miles long, 6 miles wide, and it would be in Alcatraz. He was there as an old man being punished. And it seemed like that this was the most difficult part of John's life. Let me say something right here, folks. What may seem like the most difficult part of your life, God can use it to be the most fruitful part of your life if you stop and think about it and let God to work in your life. What seemed like the hardest time in your life, God can do his best work in your life if you will allow him to do so. When it seems like, folks, that you're all alone, I want you to know something. You're not all alone. Just as Jesus saw Nathanael sitting under that fig tree, Jesus sees us when we have our moments of loneliness and going through some hard times. John was there. I wonder how John felt as he spent those years on the Isle of Patmos. By the way, folks, when he gets there, they try to do everything in the book to kill him. They put him in a pot of oil and boil him. But they said, well, that's going to take care of John. Well, it didn't. They just couldn't cook him. And so they gave him poison to drink, and he drank it, but he didn't die. All I want you to see, folks, you are immutable until God is ready for you. You are immutable until God is ready for you. Listen, if God's not ready for you, even COVID-19 is not going to take your life if God's not ready for you. And folks, if God is ready for you, there's nothing you can do to keep yourself here. I've said this before. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of a sound mind. God helps us. He is going to take care of us. We can't trust him. He will see us through. I've said so many times, tough times never last. Tough people do. So John, he says, I'm on the Isle of Patmos. I was there. And let's look at what Revelation says. Now, Revelation chapter 1, verse 1 tells us that the emphasis for the book of Revelation is on the who, not the what. And the who is Jesus. Look at verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show his servants things which surely, shortly must come to pass. And he sent and signified it by sending an angel unto his servant John. So this is a revelation of Jesus to John. This is the resurrected Christ appearing to John. And the book of Revelation, Bible scholars tell us, was written some years, 60 years after the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus. And so Jesus is revealing himself to John. Look what it says in verse 9. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Folks, here's what I've learned over the years. Many times we shine the brightest when we're going through the most difficult times in our lives. And folks, it takes a test to have a testimony. And we want to make sure after the test we have a testimony and not just the monies. A testimony. John says, wait, I was here on the Isle of Patmos, and one day I was just working in the rock quarry, and there was a cave there, and that cave was the habitation of John. This is where John had to live. He said, I was working there at that cave, and while I was working, John says, something happened to me. Look at Revelation chapter 1, verses 10 through 15. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. You know that Sunday used to be called the Lord's Day. When was the last time you referred Sunday to, well, this is the Lord's Day, it's time to go to church? We don't hear much about the Lord's Day anymore. It's just another day out of the week. So, I was in the Spirit, John says. How should church be when we do come to church? Somebody says, oh, it's dead, lifeless. That's not how God wants the church to be, folks. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. I sensed the presence of the Lord when I was in church on the Lord's Day. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. John was all about worshiping God. He was all about praising God. He was all about glorifying God. He was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. And look what he said. I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest, write in a book. Now you highlight that phrase. John, what you see, write it down in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Write it down, John. John says in verse 12, I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks, and in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment to the floor, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white as wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many, many waters. He said, John, write down what you saw. John, write down Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. After this, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. You write it down, John, that I'm going to come back and rapture the church. You write it down, John, in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. You write it down. I'm going to rapture the church, And I'm not coming back to just get the Methodists. I'm not coming back to just get the Pentecostals. I'm not coming back to get any denomination. I'm coming back to get those who know me and have known me as their personal Savior. John, you write it down. Hey, John, you write down that there's going to be a marriage supper of the Lamb. You write it down that when I come back, I'm going to reward people. I'm going to give 5 different crowns. And you write down that they're going to bring these crowns and they're going to lay them at my feet. And they are going to say, "Thou art worthy to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created." John, you write it down. That's a praise song we sing quite often in our praise and worship today. John, not only do you write that down, but you write down Revelation chapter 6. You write down that after the church is gone, that the Antichrist is going to come on the scene. You write down that it's going to be hell on earth for 7 years. You write that down. Man will work all day for a quart of wheat. You write down that the people will beg to die and death won't come. You write down that they will turn the faucets on and out from that faucet will come blood. You write down all the horrible, horrible things that's going to be. You write it down, John, because I don't want the believers to be there. You write it down, John. Be sure that you do. John, you write down at the end of those 7 years, I'm coming back. Write down Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. You write down, John, write it down, that I'm coming back. John says, "Now I saw heaven open, and behold a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." And the armies in heaven, that's us as believers, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. John, be sure you write it down. And verse 16, "And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." And when I come back, John, write it down. There's going to be a great white throne judgment in Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. And the only people that will be there will be those who don't know me. Even those who are in hell will be brought out of hell and cast into the lake of fire. John, you write it down. John says in Revelation chapter 21, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea." Look at verse 2. John says, let me tell you what I saw on the Isle of Patmos. And I, John, this blows your circuits, folks. And I, John, saw the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven. It's going to be prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God shall be with them and be their God." He said, write it down, John, verse 4, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." Isn't that good news, folks? You write it down, John. He said, John, you write it down. John said, "Lord, I've seen it. I have seen it. I see what's going to happen, Lord, and I'm writing it down." He said in Revelation 22, "You be sure and write it down, because I'm coming quickly." You be sure, John. Write it down. John said, "Lord, in light of what I have seen, so come. So come in light of what I have seen. Even so come." This is the disciple of love. John, a rugged fisherman, had a lot of flaws in his character. Jesus rebuked him many times over, and he became a changed man. And John also was a practitioner of the Word of God, and John was a prophet. You know, as I wrap up this message, I just wonder, when he was writing all these thoughts down and putting them into a book, my mind goes back to that day that Mark describes when he and Jesus were walking out on the Temple Mount, and John says, "Jesus, what's it going to be like at your second coming?" John must have said, "I knew he was going to tell me some stuff, but I did not know he was going to tell me so much of what was going to happen." All I'm trying to say, folks, why do we gather in church on the Lord's Day? Why do we be quick to give an answer to anyone who asks for the reason of the hope within us? Why do we do it? Simply because we want to make sure, beyond a shadow of doubt, that people are connected with God. And God, use me as a conduit by which your love can flow through me, and I can share that love with someone who is walking in darkness and help them turn around, changing their mind toward you, and start walking in the light. It's going to happen, folks. John saw it. John wrote it down. As a matter of fact, there's an old gospel song. You can find it on YouTube. The Gaithers that sang it. The name of the song is "John Saw." Folks, this is the youngest disciple that Jesus called to be his followers. Bible scholars say he was about 23 years old when Jesus passed by and saw that fishing boat. And he said to John and James, "Come, follow me." I trust that you will do the same thing when you become aware that God is speaking to you to come and follow me.
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and him all the way.
Thank you.